Good morning. Welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church of Columbus, Georgia. We're glad that you're here to join us as we worship God by offering our prayers and singing songs and listening to Scripture. Please come in with us that we may worship God together.
Good morning, and hear these words of the psalmist. Sing aloud to God our strength, and shout for joy to the God of Jacob. Raise a song and sound the tambourine and the sweet lyre. Sing aloud to God our strength. Let us worship God. Please be seated. And why do we pray together? We are a community. If one of us suffers, we all suffer. If one of us rejoices, we all rejoice. Let us offer our prayers in unison. Let us pray. Wonderful God, you love us, but we have not loved you. You call, but we have not listened. We walk away from neighbors in need, wrapped in our own concerns. We condone evil, prejudice, warfare, and greed. God of grace, help us to admit our sin, so that as you come to us in mercy, we may repent, turn to you, and receive forgiveness through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases, and his mercies never come to an end, and they are new every morning, and great is God's faithfulness. All who are in Christ are new creations. The old is passed away. Behold, the new has come. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Be seated.
Well, good morning, everybody. Great to see you all. I see my girls over there, but over here I've got this big set of boys. That's awesome. Well, I want to play a little game with you guys this morning, okay? It's just a little game of charades. I want to see if you know what I'm doing when I do this. Are you ready? Taking a selfie, exactly. You all knew exactly what that was, even though I didn't have a phone. Because you've seen people do this a lot, haven't you? And take selfies of themselves, right? Now, when I was a kid, taking a selfie was taking like a Polaroid camera, and it would usually be like up your nose. It wasn't really too attractive. But now, you know, we do the selfie thing. We kind of live in a little bit of a selfie society, don't we? We can take a picture of ourselves and we want to post it on social media and we want everybody to know what we're doing. And it's a lot of fun, but also sometimes we get a little too wrapped up in sharing every little minute of our lives. Now, I'm guilty of it. I've taken pictures of my soup and put it on the internet before, but I'm just telling you, it's very important for us to remember that even though we are great and we've been given these wonderful gifts and we're good folks, that we're not better than anybody else and we're certainly not better than God. Today we learned about a new penguin, because our penguins are here, and I know one of you at least remembers which one it was. Can somebody tell me which penguin you learned about today? Walker, you told me just a minute ago. I know you know. The emperor penguin. And he is the biggest penguin, and he's the most flashy penguin. He's the one with a little bit of orange on his ears and a little bit on his chest, and he's about 4 feet tall. I didn't even know penguins came that tall until we started studying this. But yes, he's the biggest penguin, but he still can't fly, and he still has to waddle like this everywhere he goes. But he might be a little bit proud, do you think? Because he's big and he's got the big chest and he's got all the pretty colors on him. Do you think he's a proud penguin? Yeah. And our lesson today was about being humble and remembering that even though we are wonderful creations of God, again, we're not better than anybody else. No one person is better than another person, and nobody is better than God. Now, the story that we learned today were about two brothers who one wanted to sit on one side of Jesus and one wanted to sit on the other side of Jesus. And Jesus said, you know, if you're willing to suffer like I am, then I'll think about it. But really, it's up to God who sits on my right side and my left side, right? Do you guys remember that story about the two brothers? Yes. So that got me to thinking about how sometimes we will run to be first. We're really guilty of that. All of us are. We want to run and we want to be first in line and we want to be first in traffic and we want to beat everybody everywhere we go. And again, that's another symbol of pride where we're trying to always one-up everybody else. I want to encourage you guys to consider slowing it down. Maybe rather than doing this so much, maybe do a little more of this and take pictures of your friends or God's beautiful creation. Maybe think a little less selfie and a little more everybody else, because that's exactly what Jesus did. When it was time to go to the cross, he went and he died for each and every one of us because he loves us so much. So let us remember that we are equal, that nobody's better than anybody else. We all might look a little different, act a little different, but it's very important that we remember to stay humble and remember that God comes first. Amen? All right, cool. Well, I have a special surprise for you guys today because we had a birthday this week. Now, the young lady whose birthday it is obviously taking a birthday sleep-in today, but Miss Liza turned 12 on Friday. So I have something special for you guys, and we want to wish her a happy birthday, and we'll celebrate Liza, and we'll also talk about being humble. Are you guys ready to pray? All right, cool. Dear God, help us to remember that you come first. And help us to remember to love our neighbor and be less selfish and be more focused on you. In Christ's name, amen. Great job. All right, come on, guys, let's go. Come on, ladies.
Well, good morning again to you all, and I greet you in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. I ask those here to please sign the attendance pad at the end of your pew and then pass it back to the point of origin. I also want to greet those who are worshiping with us by the television ministry, wherever you find yourself today, as well as those who are worshiping with us online, both now and later in the course of this day or even this week. We welcome you today as well. We are fully into our new year, and the announcements are in your bulletin of various projects coming up and opportunities. I want to highlight just a few. Sunday school continues, the Center for Christian Studies with the Life of David that Reverend Dr. Mike Stewart is leading has had episode two more to come in the week ahead. Our Reverend Alvis's mini course that he is offering took a break today because of the holiday weekend, but it resumes next week, correct? Yes. Got that one squared away. Wednesday nights, the Bible study that Reverend Stephanie Boaz is leading continues on 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. And then the Art of Marriage, a small group that we're doing, continues. Episode 2 is this week on Wednesdays. The Global Mission Week is right around the corner, even though it's just January 15th. It's coming here quicker than some of us maybe even know it. So please, that information is in the bulletin, and more things will be coming in the weeks ahead. At this point, I'd like to call forth Elder Tom Carlisle, and I'm going to do his introduction while he walks up here. He is a current member of the session. He serves with the Stewardship and Finance Ministry team, and he has a special word for us today.
Well, good morning, everyone, especially good morning on this three-day weekend, and it's wonderful to see you all here. Thanks for the opportunity to take just a minute and share with you and speak to you about our stewardship campaign for 2017. This year, we are super lucky to have Sally Haddon leading our stewardship campaign. For those of you that kind of compare last year's or previous years to this year, she is doing just a phenomenal job for us. Our theme this year is making a difference. And I originally kind of put in my words today that I think you all will make a difference. But as I shared and visited with many of you this morning, the real answer is I know that you will all make a difference for us. If we define making a difference, you can define it many different ways, but how we chose to define it this year for our campaign is really the number of people whose lives you have improved. And one of the questions you might come up with is, how are we improving people's lives? Well, our campaign this year is built around a thing called a ministry action plan, or a MAP. And this whole plan is built around changing people's lives and making a difference. And most importantly, it is really to share with the people that we are able to make this difference with, is sharing with them the love of Jesus Christ and the love of First Presbyterian Church. So here's how you can make a difference. Next Sunday, as you look at your bulletin on the front cover, there's lots of very good information, but next Sunday, the whole Sunday school hour will be dedicated to talking about our stewardship, our budget, and giving you an opportunity to actually see where our mission, ministry action plan is going and how we intend to make a difference in 2017. Sunday, the 29th of January, we're doing a dedication breakfast. That breakfast is going to be filled with wonderful prayers, wonderful fellowship, and wonderful food. And then it's going to be followed up with our typical and our traditional dedication Sunday, where we all know we will make a difference. Our prayer for Dedication Sunday is that we will all continue to make a difference on that Sunday, and with generous hearts, we all will make a difference. Thank you.
As we prepare to hear God's word, let us sing our hymn for illumination, Be Thou My Vision. Our first lesson today comes from the prophecy of Isaiah in the 49th chapter, the first 7 verses. Listen now to the word of God. Listen to me, O coastlands, pay attention, you peoples from far away. The Lord called me before I was born. While I was in my mother's womb, He named me. He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of His hand, He hid me. He made me a polished arrow, and in His quiver, He hid me away. And He said to me, You are my servant, Israel, in whom I will be glorified. But I said, I have labored in vain, and I have spent my strength for nothing in vanity. Yet surely my cause is with the Lord, and my reward with God. And now the Lord says, Who formed me in the womb to be His servant, to bring Jacob back to Him, and that Israel might be gathered to Him? For I am honored in the sight of the Lord, and my God has become my strength. He says, It is too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the survivors of Israel. I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. The Redeemer of Israel and His Holy One, to one deeply despised, abhorred by the nations, the slave of rulers, kings shall see and stand up, princes, and they shall see, and they shall prostrate themselves because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The second reading this morning comes from the Gospel of John in the second chapter. Let us listen that we may hear what God will share with us. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out all the coins from the money changers and overturned their tables. He told them, those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" And Jesus answered, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. When Jesus was in Jerusalem during the Passover festival, many believed in his name because they saw the signs that he was doing. But Jesus, on his part, would not entrust himself to them because he knew all people and needed no one to testify about anyone, for he himself knew what was in everyone. The word of the Lord. Song lyrics can sometimes make pretty good bumper stickers. You've probably seen one that says, "Stand for something or you'll fall for anything." You may know it. It's both a country ballad that Aaron Tippin covered, as well as a version of it, is a different song, completely different words, but a version of it by John Cougar Mellencamp. "Stand for something or you'll fall for anything." Standing for something is a way of making a difference. And often we think of when we make a stand, we make a declaration that is somewhat heroic. We see, think of the prophet Nathan in the Old Testament when he stood before King David. King David had been caught in an adulterous relationship with Bathsheba. But not only was it that, he had arranged for Bathsheba's husband to be killed in battle. Adultery and murder. Our revolutionary ancestors in 1776 declared their independence from Great Britain. It was a heroic stand that they made. You may recall the picture from 1989 of a sole person standing in Tiananmen Square in China in front of a tank, making a stand and making a difference. Jesus stood in the temple courtyard in Jerusalem and he made a difference. The Gospels, all four of them, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all tell this story of Jesus going to the temple and making this stand. But John does it a little bit differently. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all tell that story as part of the last days of Jesus' life and ministry on his way to the cross. John tells it at the very beginning of his ministry. John wants us to know that God came to be with us. The Word became flesh. God put on this humanity that we have and lived with us. There is something in that that lets us know right off the bat, God is making a difference in Jesus Christ for you, for me, for all people. Some Christian scholars say that the book of John can also be described as the book of signs. And in fact, in the reading, there is an allusion to the signs that Jesus did. And because Jesus did signs, people believed what he had done. And this is one of those signs. But what is it a sign for? Is it something that you just pass by as we drive by many billboards on the roads next to us? Or is it a sign that tells us something that we need to listen to? John is critiquing the temple culture of his day. He is offering a way of saying, you people are doing it wrong. He's saying Jesus is showing us a different way to be connected. The religious rites of the Jewish faith at that time called for animal sacrifice. That is what the temple was for. And to have animal sacrifice, you have to have animals. It was inconvenient. It was difficult to bring animals from your house, the place you live, to the temple. So they arranged to have the animals there, and you had to buy the animals, so you had to bring money. But there was not a uniform currency, so there were money changers there. All well and good, except that that process had lost in it the purpose of the sacrifice. The sacrifice was to help people have a better relationship with God, and that wasn't happening. And so Jesus stands there in the courtyard of the temple, and he says, you have lost your way. This is not the way it's supposed to be. This is not the way it is supposed to be. The Jews, which is in the Gospel of John code language for the leadership of that Jewish sect, the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the priest, they called him out on that, and they said, how can you do this? What gives you the authority to do this? And Jesus says, tear down this temple, tear down this building, and in 3 days I will build a new one. The temple that he was talking about had been under construction for many years. When the Romans finally did tear the temple down in the year AD 70 and then later again in the year 140, when they did tear the temple down, the foundations remain. To this day, you can go to Jerusalem, and in the center of Jerusalem, there are the remnants of the temple. You can go and see there. You can see the Western Wall, the Wailing Wall, as it is sometimes called. You can see the Gates of Huldah. You can, on top of the temple, the Dome of the Rock and a mosque have been built. It's still there. So to say it's going to come down and I'm going to rebuild it in 3 days simply was strange talk. Yet Jesus said, it's not about that. It's about the resurrection. That's what he was referring to. There is a new way of seeing life. There is a new doorway to open. There is a new way of understanding this talk about sacrifice. And you won't need animals anymore. A new way to look to resurrection, to new life, not simply in the life to come, but new life, new resurrection, where we are now, new ways of seeing things. This is what the Gospel of John is affirming, a doorway, making a stand to open a door at the beginning of his ministry so that when we think of the resurrection, we will know there is a fulfillment there. When someone makes a stand, the world shakes. At certain points in our history, different people have done different things. John F. Kennedy, when he was a senator, compiled a book called Profiles in Courage, and it contained short biographical essays of American political leaders, beginning with John Quincy Adams in the 1820s, going through the 1940s. They were men, all men, who stood against the dominant political ideas of their time for one reason or another. They were men who acted out of courage, out of hope, not with knowing that the results would be secured. There were challenges, to be sure. This weekend, we have a national holiday acknowledging the birthday of Martin Luther King Jr. King was a pastor and a theologian, and he found his faith to be lived out in a very public square, not simply in the church, but also outside of the church and in the community, all of the community. He began in Montgomery, Alabama. As a very young pastor, he had not been there very long at all when he received a call that there were people who needed assistance, people who had gone to jail for sitting on the wrong side of the aisle in the bus, and he participated in that leadership. And from that flowed so much of the other activities that we know of as the civil rights movement. From his ministry in Montgomery and then later in Atlanta at Ebenezer Baptist Church, and from his participation in the organization, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, King preached, he wrote, he marched, he led in the practice of civil disobedience. He acknowledged that there were a variety of influences that informed his actions, but his purpose was to be a disciple of Jesus Christ in all things, so that things would be set right for people in this nation and even around the world. One of his most poignant exchanges was when he was invited to Birmingham in 1963 to assist in a locally organized campaign against segregation and for economic development of African Americans. In the course of those events, King engaged in protest and he was arrested. The leading white clergy of that city, Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, Episcopalian, Catholic, and Jewish, not simply Christian, but interfaith there, published an appeal to the local leaders that appeared in the paper, and it asked them to ignore King and to engage in local negotiations. It suggested that King was an outsider and that he had extreme views. From his jail cell in Birmingham, King began to compose a letter, which we know of as the letter from the Birmingham jail. He wrote in it, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly." In the letter to the Corinthians, the Apostle Paul in the Bible wrote, "If any one member of the body of Christ suffers, all suffer together with it. If any one member of the body of Christ is honored, all rejoice with it." King drew from a deep resource of the Christian faith, just as we do every week here in worship and as we did earlier this day in the call to confession. We are a community. If one of us suffers, we all suffer. If one of us rejoices, we all rejoice. As to being an extremist, King wrote to his fellow clergy, "Was not Jesus an extremist in love? Love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Pray for those that despitefully use you. Was not Paul an extremist for the gospel of Jesus Christ? I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus." Shifting to church history, King wrote, "Was not Martin Luther an extremist, the founder of the Reformation, who stood before the council and he said, here I stand, I can do no other, so help me God. Was not Abraham Lincoln an extremist? This nation cannot survive half slave and half free." King points out, the question is not whether we will be extremist, but what kind of extremist we will be. Martin Luther King Jr. was called to make a difference, and he did. We are called to make a difference by being followers of Jesus Christ and by doing things. Sometimes we do that in ways that are notable and public, and sometimes there are things that we act upon that do not put us in the crosshairs of any sort of public conflict, but they are there nonetheless. Several years ago, a man walked into the L'Enfant Plaza station of the Washington Metro subway system. He had a violin case. He opened it, he placed it in front of him, and he began to play. He played for 43 minutes. And you know, when you pass a street musician and the case is open, you're supposed to put something there. And I'm sure some of you have passed by people who have a lot of stuff that's there. But in this case, at the end of that 43-minute segment, there was only $32.17. More than 1,000 people had walked by in those 43 minutes. But this was not an ordinary street musician. This was Joshua Bell, a world-renowned virtuoso. He was accustomed to playing in the best concert halls in the world, and the tickets for those events cost several times more than $32.17. And he played on the violin he always played on, a 300-year-old Stradivarius. I don't know a whole lot about violins, but I do know that name, and I think so many of us do. It represents a unique and special kind of instrument that's worth all sorts of money. And he played in this public place while people walked by, seemingly ignoring him. He played Bach and Schubert, and there was so not much of a response at all. This event was part of an experiment that was put together by people at the Washington Post as well as Bell. Bell thought it would be a challenge and fun. They were posing a question. If a great musician plays great music, but no one hears it, is it any good? Sort of a variation on that question, if a tree falls in the forest and no one is around to hear it, is any sound made? But there is another question that comes to my mind. If someone makes their stand and makes a difference in the world, but it's not in a place where anybody sees it, is it still a stand that makes a difference? There's a family story that I've received in recent years. I can't corroborate it because it's about my grandfather, and he's dead, and he died long before I was born. But it's a question, it's a story about making a difference. My grandfather grew up in North Mississippi. He was the youngest of four children, and a little more than 100 years ago, living in the rural South, many people chose to decide to move to the city, and they moved to the nearest city, which was Memphis, Tennessee. In Memphis, he was able to get a job in an office. He wasn't doing manual labor. He was in an office, which was supposedly a social status. And in this office, it was a business, and they sold eyeglasses. It was a national company, and he would work with customers, and later he would work with in the office and in doing things for the business. He rose to the level of being the assistant store manager, and he could not be promoted because he only had a grade school education. As I said, I never knew my grandfather, but I have been told he was a pretty hard man. He came from Scotch-Irish descendants. The family was Presbyterian, the Presbyterian variety known as the Associate Reform Presbyterians, sometimes called Blue Stockings, pretty plain and direct folks. They didn't sing songs other than things that came directly from the Book of Psalms in their churches, no hymns, no organs, no stained glass. When they moved to Memphis, one of the older sisters, who was the matriarch of the clan, decided that she was going to read the Bible and find out the true religion, and she became a Baptist, and everybody else did too, so that ended that Presbyterian strain. We would have some conversations today, I'm sure, and we will have some conversations in the future, I know, about that. But they went on their way, and one day in his work, his boss came to him and said, there are going to be other store managers coming to Memphis for a convention, for a business gathering, and we're in charge of providing the hospitality for them. So I want you to go out and procure some prostitutes for us. My grandfather, as I said, was a very simple man. He was a religious fundamentalist. He was strong in his conviction. And in my family, I have always learned that you obey direct orders. and I am sure that he was probably of that same cloth. But he told his boss that he would not do that. He would not do what he was asked to do. I don't know what happened. I don't know if somebody else went out and made those arrangements. I don't know if he was reprimanded by his boss, suffered any sort of economic penalty because of that. It's not the kind of stuff that was then put in the newspapers. And but it went on then. It goes on now. But it was a stand. It was not a stand that he made in the streets. It was not a stand that actually is told very often in our family. In fact, I have only learned of it recently, and I learned from it of my mother, who told me that she was told of it by her mother long after my grandfather was dead. It is one of those oral tradition pieces, so I can't corroborate it. But it fits. It makes sense with who I know of the people that tell me these things. You make a stand. Jesus stood at the temple, and he opened the doors to resurrection as he made his stand to say, it's not like this. There is new life in a new way. Martin Luther King wrote a letter from a jail, and he challenged the establishment to make his stand to say, we are connected. What happens to one of us impacts all of us. A violinist goes into a busy terminal station. No one seems to notice, yet still there is beauty and there is music that was created in that space and in that time. A man did not do what he was told because he believed to be an act of destruction and wrong. In some form or fashion, each one of these acts made a difference for goodness, for grace, for hope, for the love of God. When you and I come to our own moments in our own lives, when we are asked these sorts of questions, I pray that you and I will be able to take a stand that makes a difference. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to stand that we may affirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into hell, and at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Thank you.
Please be seated and let us pray. Almighty, grace-giving and loving God, we pray to be fierce and fearless, focused and faithful. We pray to be fierce in our commitment to you, to serve with passion in our daily lives, to make decisions that glorify you and that build up those around us and take us deeper to your heart. We pray to be fearless as we step out to serve where you call us to serve in a way that is visible, in a way that only you, O Lord, see. May we go out with fearless confidence from the Holy Spirit. And we pray to be focused. May we remember your stubborn love for us, that your grace is sufficient, your plan is perfect and worth following. We pray to be faithful as we continue to pray for friends and loved ones, those battling disease, those grieving losses, and those who wrestle with discouragement and depression, those seeking wisdom as they make critical decisions as well. May we live today and the week ahead as your fierce and fearless, focused and faithful disciples. In Jesus' name we pray as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And let us continue our worship as we present to God our tithes, our offerings, our gifts, and our very selves. Almighty, gracious, and loving God, we give you humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all people. We thank you for all the blessings of this life, and we dedicate these tithes, these offerings, these gifts in the strong name of Jesus Christ, that they may in turn bless others in Jesus' name. Amen.
When we began worship this day, we sang a hymn that had a refrain, "Grant us wisdom, grant us courage." As we engage in the activities of our lives, as we walk into the public square or into our private homes, may we understand those times when we need courage and wisdom so that we may make a stand that makes a difference for God's love in the world, reaching out through Jesus Christ. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit surround you and be with you. May it be with you as you breathe in and as you breathe out. May it accompany you with every step you take and every stride you make this day and always. Amen.
It's been a privilege to join you this day in worship. We're glad that you were here. First Presbyterian Church seeks to serve and minister in the name of Jesus Christ. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor. Go in peace as you love and serve God.